Today's show is brought to you by Zipcar.com. Earn $25 of free driving credit at joinzipcar.com/David Feldman Show.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Barry Crimmins joins us from upstate New York. Mr. Crimmins is, well, come on. We all know who Barry Crimmins is. And you join us with pneumonia, and I think I have pneumonia, sir.
Yeah. Well, the old man's friend.
I've had a cold for 3 weeks. People who listen to this show know that I've had this cough.
Yes, the slow deterioration.
And we'll
have a nice record of it, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I want to ask you a couple questions about pneumonia. You're a wonderful political satirist.
Mm-hmm.
And Hillary Clinton had walking pneumonia and
yeah.
the boogie woogie whatever blues or something.
Yeah.
And she collapsed into her car and everybody mm-hmm. said she shouldn't be president. And I'm thinking.
Right, because she can catch it. I mean, you know, I got my issues with her, but for goodness sake. You know, I mean, I find myself, you know, I'm not her age. I'm a little younger than her, but I've been on the road for 3 years kicking it in the air. And, you know, things catch up with you sometimes. And you just need a few days to get better.
Right. What do they do?
And by the way, at no point would I be unable to carry out duties or be briefed on something or whatever, as her opponent refuses to be under any circumstances, even by his own people.
Right. You'd still be able to order drone strikes on Arab Americans overseas, right?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm still completely capable of carrying out the presidential obligation to completely destroy other people's health.
Good. I am curious, if you don't mind my asking,
mm-hmm.
are you voting for Jill Stein?
I'm not. You know what? I don't know. I'm not. I've taken a step. Here's how far I went in this election. I formally denounced Trump a few months ago.
Wow, that took a lot of courage on your part.
And obviously, I mean, if you understand the Electoral College and whatever, you're not forced into certain things if you're in certain states.
Wait, but you are now.
But I don't like Stein on the inoculation stuff. I don't like, you know, I mean, it's just whatever.
But you believe
in Yoko and me.
Right. But you denounced Donald Trump. You're disassociating yourself. That's a brave stance to take. Is that because?
Well, I took it. I did it months ago.
Is that because you have a daughter and because you have a sister and a mother?
No. I have no daughter. I have two. Yeah, I have two daughters, Letty and Lou, the dog.
Mm-hmm.
They're sisters. So.
Because only a.
But I mean, you know, clearly he's always been a creep. You know, just. He is to beauty pageant contestants what Jerry Sandusky is to at-risk boys.
So I do a radio show with Ralph Nader, who said on the show a year ago, when Trump came down the escalator to announce, he said, "Do not underestimate this man. Do not underestimate a carnival barker who he can go very far in the Republican Party." And I thought Ralph Nader was wrong. And he is.
Do that at your own peril.
And so then I asked him. One of the treats of talking to Ralph Nader once a week is I get to pretend I'm a policy wonk, that I don't have to watch MSNBC and CNN to see who's up, who's down, all the nonsense of the horse race. We can you can talk about real substance.
Well, I mean, in particular, the abject ignorance of the Electoral College, talking about the national percentages just doesn't mean anything.
Right.
You could win five states by a million votes apiece and lose 12 by 100 votes apiece, and you lose.
How much?
So, and if they wanted, I mean, you know, it'd be nice to have a national, it'd be nice to have direct democracy. We don't.
Well, let me ask you about this election, because it's 3 weeks away.
Yeah.
I do not watch CNN, MSNBC, or Fox.
Right.
I find it to be a
I take them in for a few minutes in the morning and can run on that vitriol all day.
Right. I listen to Rachel Maddow as a podcast and Amy Goodman as a podcast. Amy Goodman from Pacifica. But I need to be informed. I don't need to be revved up. And for the most part, you're not really getting. I mean, they'll stay all day. They'll talk about one or two women who are coming forward saying they were fondled, and that becomes the story. And then,
well, fondled is not a. Fondle could be fun. The correct term would be gross sexual imposition.
Yeah.
If you, you know, I don't. And by the way, I played a lot of sports, and never heard that in a locker room.
I
heard dumbass stuff in a locker room, and those guys ended up getting stuffed in their locker with a fucking jock strap in their mouth.
Right.
But, you know.
I don't locker room talk. I have never talked to another guy in a locker room. I just get dressed as quickly as I can in order not to be haunted by another man's penis. I mean, I just want to get dressed, get out of there. Nobody talks.
I mean, that's not interested. But, you know, I mean.
Hello?
Your team in the locker room. But, you know, when I was in the locker room, we were talking about the next game, you know, or, boy, the coach ran us hard today, or whatever. And then we might be trying to figure out who was getting the beer later on, you know.
Right.
But that was about as racy as it got.
So,
and, you know, I mean, at the level I played at, you knew the girls when I was a kid, and women when you get a little older, you know them, because it's a local thing, and, you know, you're talking about people I know. So if someone said that kind of shit around me, it wouldn't be good.
Yeah, it's almost as though you wonder what kind of role.
Trump just is this, but I mean, what it comes down to is, like, well, either he did this or he bragged about doing it, either, you know. So now, one way or the other, I mean, he's caught in a lie, because he's either saying, well, I was lying when I said that, or I'm lying now. And with all the women coming forward, it does seem like, you know, there's a lot of, you know. I mean, and I don't want to not, you know, because I really enjoyed his comedy albums in the 60s. Oh, wait, that's another guy.
Yeah. That's Bill. And not Clinton.
Yeah.
Let me ask my question to put this in context, and then we'll get back.
Why are there heirs, I believe, with an H?
Yeah. Wow.
Huh?
I can't laugh because I'll start coughing. But that,
yeah.
Right. Yes. So let me put this into context for me. So I asked Ralph Nader this question, and I'm going to ask you this question. And yes, I'm name dropping Ralph Nader. Okay. You said to me.
Yeah, I was pretty sure it wasn't me.
Yeah. You said in the past, I don't want to talk about Donald Trump. I don't want to talk about Donald Trump. At what point does Donald Trump become as important as policy? At what point now?
Well, let me tell you right now that right now, this is very important. At least people are concerned about Homeland Security. Well, if the Homeland isn't someplace, if our country isn't someplace where a woman can go to work safely, where a little kid can be safe in their home from an abusive parent, whatever, and you get these nitwits going like, oh, these whiners, and so, you know, and they're meant to censor and shut up victims. That's a very serious thing, and I'm tired of everyone saying, oh, let's get on to something more important. Well, you know what? You stumbled into something extraordinarily important that I've been trying to make part of the discussion for a long time now.
Well, let me push back on this, because I'm going to play the devil's advocate here.
No, not you.
Not me. So I'm going to, just for the sake of conversation, I may or may not believe what I'm saying.
Yeah, okay, I know.
I may or may not know if I believe what I'm saying. I was a defender of Bill Clinton. I now look back and realize Bill Clinton was a horrible president.
But
it really was. It was a disaster.
I mean, you know, the fairness doctrine, the you know, the
welfare reform.
After 12 years of Reagan and Bush, the only thing he reformed were poor people.
Right.
Yeah, he's not my favorite.
Yeah. So I think, okay, and he's a rapist. Can we agree that Bill Clinton is a rapist?
Well, prove it. I can't. See, here's the thing. I can't. I'm in a position as regards sexual abuse and rape, particularly of children, where there people are waiting for me for my Chicken Little moment.
Right.
So if you can prove it, fine. If you can't, I'm not jumping off the cliff and asking why on the way down, because I feel a sincere obligation to a bunch of people who are not spoken for or and who are, in many cases, still terrified to say anything. But my personal life, since Bobcat made the movie about me in particular, every day I hear from people who in many, many cases, are disclosing for the first time in their lives to someone the trauma they suffered as children or as a worker someplace or what have you. And so, you know, I feel it's a very, I take that responsibility with grave seriousness. I won't say, oh, Bill Clinton's a rapist. I don't know that he's a rapist. He's a cheesy guy who clearly was unfaithful to his wife, and I know that. I would say that his behavior might be traceable to his own childhood. I try to find the source of things. And it seems to me that he grew up in a small town with a mother who was apparently a bit promiscuous, and I'm sure he was pretty humiliated by that. And anyway, people accommodate things like that in different fashions.
When I was defending Bill Clinton,
okay,
I said
I wasn't.
Right. Okay. When I was defending,
and by the way, I mean, you know, particularly the Monica Lewinsky thing. That's just like we were learning about rape. We were beginning to, you know, we were in the early stages of beginning to be cognizant of what women go through in this world. And we were talking about things like power imbalance. And suddenly every Democrat in the world had just lost track of this thing that we gained a lot of ground on. But if you take, you know, a woman who had been an intern a couple weeks ago, And suddenly she's involved in a sexual situation with the commander in chief of the largest military force ever assembled. That's a power imbalance, and I that's where I took issue right away.
If anything, I defended her. Right.
You know?
Right. That's God bless you, and I agree with you 100%.
Yeah.
What I wrestled with. Afterwards, but during this, this is what I said, and this is what people are still saying, and I'm so glad to have you on to disabuse Democrats of this. I'm not a neoliberal, but the neoliberals said was, who cares about character? Character has nothing to do with being a president or a governor or a senator. Character is what you bring up when you're too lazy to read the New York Times and study policy and concern yourself with the inner workings of government. We turn to the issue of character because that's what the American people understand, because they're illiterate. They're the great unwashed. Character has nothing to do with getting the job done.
Yeah, well,
but, in
particular, if you feel the job is remaining in power,
right?
You know, but so, if the job is doing the best possible job you can, and holding yourself to the same standard that you expect others to hold to, or that you imply you expect others to hold to, then character's got a little something to do with it.
Okay, so
I got to tell you, it's no big thing. I'm far from saintly. But, you know, I've taken a number of lumps over the years because I at least, in my judgment, knew what I thought was right and wrong and acted accordingly.
Yeah, as a progressive liberal.
And I would much rather live, you know, I would much rather risk the disdain of the whole world than be guaranteed of my own self-loathing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think in this guy Trump, you're seeing a guy who fucking hates himself.
We'll get to that in a second.
Projecting his self-loathing on the entire world.
We'll get to Trump in a second. I want to talk about the I want to talk about the national discussion first.
Okay.
And then we'll dig down into the weeds. And by weeds, I mean his hair. That I am utterly convinced, like before the debate, the last debate started.
Yeah.
When we were going to hear all about Billy Bush and what Donald Trump said. I was saying to my friends, you know, one out of four kids in America is in poverty.
Yeah.
You know, 900...
Which is another form of abuse.
Yeah. 900 Americans were killed by cops this year. Mm-hmm. This is what we're discussing? That Bill Clinton was a rapist and Donald Trump was a rapist and a racist?
And a racist.
Yeah.
But...
Why are we just, what is this character
nonsense? I'll tell you the one thing that disturbed me about that press conference was I felt if those women are actual victims, boy, did they get used. And if they're now, I mean, you know, and no matter what, even if it was my, you know, even if it was my very abuser himself, I'm not going to go to a press conference with a guy who I just heard say the things we heard him say a couple days earlier.
Right.
I'm just not going to do that out of respect for all victims. And you know, I mean, I'm just not going to do that. That was a terrible thing. But really, you're running against Breitbart News now. It's not the Republican Party anymore. It's Breitbart News is at the, you know, the front of the ticket.
The as you've been doing the show long enough to know that there are two words I love to use when I'm interviewing somebody. One of the words is germane, and the other word is niggardly. I like to say niggardly on the show to show people that I'm smart, not a racist. I'm not going to use niggardly today. I'm going to be niggardly with the word niggardly and not use it today. I'm going to use the word germane.
Okay.
Germane, not Jermaine Jackson.
That's not clever enough for you, but go on.
Okay, I'm going to talk about nothing. That's, clever?
You know,
who said anything about it? But I'm going to use the word germane today.
Okay. Yes.
Is this germane?
Yes.
It is germane.
It's extraordinarily germane. I mean, the guys, you know, and I mean, again, at best, he's a guy who boasts about sexually assaulting women. At worst, he's a guy who sexually assaults women.
Okay, Bernie Sanders.
Yeah.
I'm going to assume that you were...
I was for Bernie.
Okay. If at this hour, let's say Bernie got the nomination...
I mean, right now, you know where we'd be if he was running? He would be waltzing away with this, and we would have an extraordinarily progressive, by U.S. standards, president headed for the Oval Office with a mandate.
Okay.
So it's pretty sad.
Okay. If you were to find out that Bernie Sanders, had he been in the bus with Billy Bush?
Yeah.
Saying those things. Now, I know the answer is Bernie Sanders would never talk that way because...
No. I'm not going to... No, just I'll take your hypothetical. Keep going.
Would you defend him?
No.
And what would you do? Would you vote for Trump?
No, I still wouldn't vote for Trump, but, you know, I'm not going to defend someone who boasts of sexually assaulting people.
Would you be willing, if Bernie Sanders is running on a platform of single payer for all, and I happen to believe my issue is single payer for all. I'm a one issue candidate, and I think there are a lot. I'm all for identity politics. I'm all for peace. But the one issue in this country for me that I think transcends everything is single payer for all. That's the top of my list. That's 90% of what I care about. Single payer for all. And I'm utterly convinced that if Bernie Sanders had gotten elected president, it would have been through a landslide. He would have carried. The House would have flipped, and we would have gotten single payer for all. Would you be willing to put a rapist in the Oval Office for 4 years if it meant single payer for all?
No, I mean, this is just a crucial, issue. I can't throw. I mean, I know most people don't have my life and don't deal with the people I deal with, but I have these sort of packs with hundreds of people who confide in me, who expect me to maintain a single standard on this stuff, and I can't sell them down the river.
Right.
And what I do and say probably wouldn't change that much. But anyway, this is an extreme hypothetical.
It's an extreme hypothetical.
Bernie isn't that guy.
But that,
you know?
But that is what we thought during that. Not you, but that's what I believed during the Clinton impeachment. That he shouldn't.
Well, we see how good they are on health now. It's, you know.
But there were people like me who said, hey, I have a mother, I have a daughter, I have a sister, I have a...
Yeah, I never say that shit. I'm me.
I know.
You know.
I know.
I'm me. I don't need to use the women in my life and family as human shields.
Well, it makes me... I like to patronize.
Make it seem like, well, I have to take as much as you know, as distasteful as it is for me to have to take a stand on this crucial issue that permeates everything, particularly child abuse. Because kids, to make sense of the world, kids who are abused, make sense of the world. They start out by thinking there's something wrong, and no one says, yes, there is something wrong. That was wrong what they did to you. So after a while, they start thinking there's something wrong with me. And then the self-loathing comes in, and here comes your bigot, you this, you that, because once you can't hate anyone until you hate yourself. So I see that as, in the long run, if we could reverse things and have the courage to face the kind of trauma that so many people have to overcome one way or the other, make it okay for them to speak up about it, make it okay for there to be an honest discussion about it, make it okay for people to acknowledge that they aren't, that they shouldn't just have a knee-jerk reaction on this, but they should, that there's a lot in it for them to really learn about these issues, then I don't think single payer would be that far behind anyway.
Okay. All right. But you would, I think my answer, unfortunately, would be different. But it's a different hypothetical.
Okay.
But, you know, it's a different hypothetical. My feeling
is, I'm getting a lot of different data you don't get.
Yeah.
You know,
my hypothetical is, in my world, if I knew Bernie Sanders was like Donald Trump, but it meant single payer and 50,000 people wouldn't die every year because they don't have health insurance.
Right.
You know, as the, you know, the Democrats said, you know, Bill Clinton's a sexual harasser, but he's my sexual harasser.
Right.
That's what they thought.
Well, I never, I was okay. I mean, I was in the right place on that one. Mm-hmm. And it was while he was president that I kind of sorted my own life out. But, you know,
right.
I'd like, you know, but I mean, a lot of people think my politics come from the fact that I survived rape as a 4 or 5 year old.
Do you think Obama?
What I like to think is that, you know, everybody else at the anti-death squad rally wasn't raped.
Right.
I would like to think that I might have had enough character and enough insight and been thoughtful and compassionate enough to oppose horrid brutality.
Right. Do you think Obama has character?
Pardon me? That's a little oversimplified, you know,
to just say.
I mean, I think a lot of comics, that's why he didn't talk about the airline peanuts, because he's been raped. Now his insanity is much more. What I've done, I don't think was ever insane.
Right.
You know?
Well, do you think President Obama has character?
Certainly more than either of the current candidates, but I mean, you know, he's a politician, and you know, just look at that mayor of Chicago that he answered to a lot. Look at what he's done. There's some problems there, and the money he took from Goldman Sachs and so on and so forth, and how after the Occupy thing, you know, happened in the fall, they started Occupy Spring, and it was basically an arm of the Obama campaign, and it was used to undermine a movement that was really cool in the sense that finally some people got it, well, understood things well enough to not go to Washington and pretend you're going to get any answers there, but they went to the real bosses and made their lives miserable. And so they basically, he gets reelected and Holder goes on and, you know, destroys freedom of assembly. So that's, you know, and Obama's smart enough to know what happened there. But, you know, do I completely condemn him? No, I don't. I mean, you know, he has his moments and he stood up and he's, you know, done some decent things in the past couple of years in particular.
Barry Crimmins is the author of Never Shake Hands with a War Criminal, and that war criminal you're talking about is Henry Kissinger. And I always think about this book, and I always think about that moment at CNN when you refuse to shake Henry Kissinger's hand.
Right.
So many people would say, Barry, come on. You know, you're being rude to Henry Kissinger. Shake his hand.
I think it's rude to massacre people. So.
And I always think about this.
Depends. I'm not telling anybody else what to do. I mean, I guess it sounds like I am with that. But the full line there is, well, you know, why didn't you shake hands with Dr. Kissinger? And my immediate response was because I have a strict policy of never shaking hands with a war criminal. And then the CNN anchor I was talking to, Norma Quarles, said, oh, that's right, I forgot, which was the real funny payoff to the whole thing in an awful sort of way.
That's right, I forgot. And she's and she's anchoring CNN, and she forgot.
She was, yeah.
And he's consulting. And he's consulting. You know what? That's probably the best response you could have gotten from a CNN anchor. I forgot.
Yeah.
She was willing to acknowledge it.
Yeah, well, I mean, it was just her and me. I don't know. She probably figured I wasn't going to write a... She didn't have time to think for... You know, but whatever. She didn't get any trouble for it. And I don't want her to.
Uh-huh. Would you shake hands with Ivanka Trump, Donald Jr., and Eric Trump?
Would I?
Yeah.
No. This is. I mean, they get the blood of those animals on their hands, for starters, and they're creeps. You know?
Right. So I
really disagreed with Clinton when she complimented him on her kids.
Right.
His kids.
Right.
They're awful.
I mean, I would get into trouble with my mother. It is conceivable that in the next 5 years, I will meet Ivanka Trump, or Eric Trump, or Donald Jr.
Yeah.
And I like to think that I would say to them, you know, your father raped your mother.
Yeah.
And you still support it. You must really hate your mother to support, or you must really love money.
I mean, at that point, you're getting into some real...
And if I did that, my mother would say,
I mean, you know, these people are really... I mean, if you look at the Trump... If you want to talk about lineage, you go back to the Trump's grandfather, who was a pimp, a large, wide-scale pimp, and his father's a racist slumlord, redundancy noted.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, it's not like, you know, he doesn't come from class, which is why he's always talking about it. You know, he's not, you know, he's as from the gutter as you can get.
One of the tragedies this year is that Sidney Sheinberg passed away.
Yeah.
Who went from the killing fields, he wrote about what America did in Cambodia, to what Donald Trump did to New York City. That when he came back from Cambodia, Sidney Sheinberg became a columnist for the New York Times, and he looked around and he said, who's the closest we have to Pol Pot here in the late 70s, early 80s?
By the way, I don't know if you know this, but... Kissinger won the mineral rights to the killing fields.
Don't make me laugh.
Okay.
I'll start coughing.
Right.
And then
well, you got the right guy on today, then.
And so, and what really pisses me off is that Sidney Sheinberg died this year. And Sidney Sheinberg was one of the first journalists
to identify Trump as the scum that he is.
Yeah. What he was doing to New York City, how he got these buildings erected.
Well, I mean, he was walking the public point on that. You know, it's why he's hated by a lot of the other scumbags, because, you know, they know how to operate quietly. And he, you know, basically, he's as discreet as, you know, Don King.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you haven't answered my question, or maybe I wasn't paying attention. Are you going to vote?
Yeah, I'm going to vote.
Do you mind if I ask you again? Because maybe my mind wandered.
Yes. Yeah, I mind. I don't want to get into that. I'm not voting for Trump. That's all I'm going to say. There's some other options. Certainly, there's a lot of other people on the ballot. I might blank the presidency. It depends. I mean, if Clinton's up by 20, 25 points in New York, why do I have to soil myself and vote for Henry Kissinger's friend? I don't have to. If I'm in Florida, I probably would have to. If I'm in Ohio, I probably have to. Maybe even Pennsylvania. But I'm not. I'm in New York State, you know, and he's not going to win here. He's not going to win here if he cures cancer the night before the election. They've made my vote not count with the Electoral College. All I'll do is acknowledge that on some level, and I've been able to do that in other elections where it didn't make a damn bit of difference who I voted for. It doesn't make a difference who I'm going to vote for in New York State because it's a foregone conclusion.
So
if Trump wins New York, you come back at me.
So there's a comedy legend. I'm not going to mention the name because I'd rather talk candidly with you about this. I don't want to mention the name, not out of respect, but just because, we'll discuss why I don't want to mention his name. So they keep asking me to put this famous elder statesman of comedy on my show, and I go, no. I'm not interested.
Mm-hmm. Because, why is that?
Huh?
Why is that?
Because I remember reading 10 years ago that his daughter wrote a book and said that she was raped.
Yes, I know of whom you speak.
She was raped by her father.
Yeah.
And so I've read up on it again to decide, and I kind of got a bad taste in my mouth, and I said, you know what? It doesn't sit well with me. I believe the daughter. It sounds like he was a drug user and manipulative, just from what I've read. And
this is unfair to most drug users, but yes, go on.
Right, and he probably...
I mean, I've gotten pretty high in my day. I never raped anybody, but
yeah,
go on,
yeah,
particularly
yeah.
a child.
Yep.
I mean, but anybody.
Yeah. And so I said, nah, there are plenty of guests we can have on the show. I don't need to shake hands with him. I swear to you,
right.
I thought of your book, Shake Hands, Don't Shake Hands with a
right.
War Criminal.
Right.
And I didn't have him on the show. And I'm still getting pressure to have him on the show. And there's a little part of me that feels I'm being unfair because for two reasons.
Well, I know the case you speak about, and I think there's some compelling stuff there. And it hasn't been sorted out. I mean, people think I'll sign off on anyone who's accused of anything, and I don't. Because the last thing I need to do with the stands I've taken and the stuff that people don't want to know about that I'm already talking about, they're looking to discredit me and turn me into Chicken Little. So I know who you're talking about, and I actually had a golden opportunity to say something to him in a very public setting, but it would have been me showing off as this judge, jury, and executioner, and that would be irresponsible in particular, again, to those people I deal with every day. So I'm cautious. I'm very cautious. It's also why people come at me with these conspiracy theories and stuff. It's like, look, you know, people already think, even though I went to the point of, oh, you don't think children are sexually abused, and I ended up turning over an awful lot of child pornography to the feds, in which there were photographs of exactly what I was talking about that people don't want to believe happens that much.
That's in a movie called Call Me Lucky, directed by
Call
Bob
Me Ke- Lucky, yeah.
Called directed by Bobcat Goldthwait. It's a documentary
right.
about Barry Crimmins. Everybody should download it on iTunes or Netflix.
It's on Netflix too.
On Netflix, and it tells the story of Barry Crimmins.
It tells the story of me surviving, me being a comic, surviving abuse, you know, sort of my whatever.
And going before Congress and exposing
child pornography trafficking in America online.
Right.
And now they're talking about making a dramatic movie about it. Goldthwait directing and Judd Apatow producing. So that's pretty crazy.
Yep. And so...
About that part of it, you know, the AOL part.
So you struggled with what I kind of struggled with, because this is what I thought. I thought if this guy were big and famous now and influential...
Well, you love to find reasons to beat yourself up, you know, not celebrate yourself for at least, you know.
Would I?
You didn't do it. You didn't cave.
But would I have had him on the show if he were, you know, if he could have helped me? Because I don't think he could. I don't think he could help the show. I don't think he's going to. Maybe, but.
Well, the guy's powerful and connected and knows a lot of people and has been involved in amazing projects. And he's a very funny person, smart.
And so people. Say what? They say I'm going to work with him because he never went to prison, because it was never proven in a court of law, because children have imaginations and she never pressed charges, right?
Yeah, well, there's things like statutes of limitations and so on that work toward. I mean, you know, it takes a long time for a kid to realize the damage that's done, particularly when it's that inside, when it's an incest, and you're just sort of like this primal source in your life is betraying you, and you have no context for that. And it takes a long time for most people to speak up about a thing like that.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And even, man, I'll tell you, we had this thing in this country for a long time during the Clinton years. The biggest initiative they had concerning sexual abuse of children was called family reunification. And what that was a kid would come forward and say, my father's raping me. And they would say, well, you tell us the whole story. You never have to worry about this again. You're going to be protected. We're going to put you somewhere safe, so on and so forth. Then they take the father, put him in this, you know, reeducation thing for 6 months, and then they bring the kid back to the house with the father. Family reunification sounds like a great thing. It sounds like meeting, you know, your brother at the train station after World War II. But what it's doing is, name any other situation where a rape victim is forced to live with a much stronger and more powerful person in the same domicile. And it's some sort of, and literally you couldn't get, states couldn't get federal funds unless they participated in this family reunification shit.
And this was a Bill Clinton initiative?
Federal program. Well, that was, he was president, and it went on. I don't think, they're not doing it anymore, last I checked, but it sounds great. Again, family reunification, but suddenly the one place, the one rape, the one, you know, child abuser you can supposedly cure is an incestuous father or mother or whatever, brother. It's crazy.
Has there ever been evidence of a single, do we call them pedophilia? What do you call them? Pederans?
Well, there's all sorts of, you know, depending on the age and stuff. And to tell you the truth, I don't have that memorized. But
can it be cured?
Anyone offending in that fashion past a certain age, I consider hopeless. Particularly, who knows, maybe not if we didn't have such a draconian prison system that did, among other things, encourage the rape of rapists and so on. But, you know, it's... The odds are pretty grim, and again, these people are just working towards, you know, even when they're in jail, they're just planning their next offense. They're possessed. It's a terrible, terrible thing, and their lives must be hell. When I learned of who had raped me, I got him identified and whatever, and I learned about him, and then I found out the same moment I found out who he was, right away I learned that he had died in prison the previous year. And a lot of people think I'm soft because I just felt bad. It was like, what a complete waste of a life. And then later on, I learned more about him. And he came out of, you know, a very abusive home and then went into abusive foster care and so on and so forth. And was was one of the people who became a perpetrator. Although most people who are sexually abused as children don't become sexual abusers. But, you know, there's almost no sexual abusers who weren't sexually abused. There's sexual abusers of children who weren't sexually abused.
So you're saying...
I can't speak to the crimes committed by adults against adults.
So you're saying most sexual abusers were sexually abused?
Yes.
So then, because I was told, and I've read, that you really can't cure a child molester.
Well, once, I mean, you know, it's sure, under the current situation, I mean, like, look, you got to gamble on somebody. Who am I going to gamble on? The perpetrator of these crimes or the next kid they run into? I mean, who am I going to put at stake? And I'm sorry, I don't care if these guys end up in a prison with two golf courses and tennis courts and, you know, and a sauna, you know, and cable TV. That doesn't matter to me. I just want them segregated from children because they're a clear and present danger. I don't believe in confirming the MO of brutality at any level. You know, I wish our prisons were actually lawful places. You know, that would be a start. You know, we might be able to begin to figure out some stuff where prisoners actually kind of caught on that there's plenty of times when the law works in your favor. Mm-hmm. And you might become more respectful of it. But when, you know, when you got people snickering about prison rape and whatever, it's just, you know, it's lawless. I mean, you know, people should be able to go into prison without worrying about, you know, white supremacists or some other gang coming after them and rape being used as a weapon and, you know, it being, and, you know, all sorts of narcotics and so on and so forth. But it's, you know, not, our system is into punishment and throwing people away. And so under that current situation, I don't see where you can let someone out who's been offending, who's been raping children. You can let them back out on the street at any point. And that includes when they're 80 years old, because even if they're impotent or if they've been castrated chemically, they'll pick up a stick and harm a child.
Yeah, because it has nothing to do with the penis, mm-hmm. really.
Well, probably.
Yeah.
I don't think.
We're going to wrap it up. I'm going to say something, and then you'll respond to it.
Okay, well, this has been, you know,
let me
cheer up everybody today.
Oh,
but, I mean, you know, thank you for letting me
talk about these issues. I'm not done.
Oh, okay.
I'm not done yet. Because there is the area of false accusations.
Did you ever think I might be?
Oh, well, from the beginning, I figured you were done.
This is over. Okay, go on.
Okay. The issue of false accusations. I want to say something about
sure.
this. I want to say something, and then you can respond. Okay. I came of age around the time of the Anita Hill McMartin preschool stories.
Right. Well,
Okay. So let me just say this, and then you respond.
Say something. I'm going to tell you an art project I always wanted to do.
Okay. So without you, you may disagree, but conventional wisdom, and you can respond to this later, is that the McMartin preschool accusations were false, that the kids had active imaginations and that Bucky McMartin and the whole family were kind of ruined by child psychologists,
right.
And they were victims of false accusations. Around the same time, Anita Hill accused Clarence
right.
Thomas of sexual harassment.
Right, right. With the help of David Brock.
David Brock.
She was ruined. Yeah.
Right.
I was with her when she was Anita Hill.
Right. David Brock used to be a closeted homosexual who found solace with the Republican Party, because that is a place where if you're in the closet and you're damaged and you hate yourself, you go to the Republicans, and he won't.
Well, there's a number of people who just project their self-loathing on society.
Right.
J. Edgar Hoover being a prime case of that.
Right. So, and he wrote for the American Spectator. David Brock did, and he was in the closet, and he did a hatchet job on Anita Hill. He did a hatchet job on Bill Clinton, and facilitated Paula Jones coming forward, and he mm-hmm. personally is kind of responsible for Bill Clinton's impeachment. He came out of the closet, immediately apologized to the Clintons, and now works. He kind of makes money off the Clintons. The bridge.
Oh, he pack. Runs. I mean, he's the online hitman.
Yeah. Yeah, Media Matters. He has a website called Media Matters, which is fantastic. So the point I'm making is, I said this about Clarence Thomas. I know he was guilty of it. of harassing Anita Hill when they were working at the EEOC, where you're supposed to prosecute sexual harassment, not perpetuate it.
Right.
I said, you know, in this day and age, it doesn't matter if we have false accusations of sexual harassment in the workplace. A couple of guys are going to have to go down publicly for the nation to learn how to behave in an office. That was Let me just finish.
Okay.
Let me just finish this, and then I'm done. I said this in I don't know, was it 89 or 90, whenever Anita Hill was. I said, you know what? Yes, there is such thing as false accusations. If a couple of guys get fired and sued to scare the bejesus out of men to behave properly in the workplace, it's worth it.
Yeah.
That's what I said. And then, you know, I kind of entered the workplace as a comedy writer and had kids, aware that there is such things as false accusations, false memory, that coworkers.
False memory, by the way, is, you know, the person who wrote all the quote unquote science about that. A guy named Ralph Underweger.
We'll get to that in a second.
He gave an interview to an organization called Heidecker,
the Journal of Pedophilia.
It's his quote-unquote science that this stuff is all based on.
Okay, we'll get to that in a second.
Put that up.
Okay, so when I started working in the 90s and having children, I said, and my mother said to me, watch your step. My mother said, you're an asshole. Watch your step. People are gunning for you. They're going to want to accuse you of sexual harassment and God knows what else. Watch your step. And I'm going to make you laugh. I was like a priest in the office. I'm being funny. But
let's hope not.
I know.
Yeah.
But, you know, I knew how to behave in an office.
Right.
And I dare any woman or man to come forward and accuse me of sexual harassment because I got the message. And also, you know, whatever. I don't really want to bring up the McMartin preschool. I got the message. This is how you're supposed to behave. So when I see Donald Trump making those jokes and talking that way.
Oh, no one respects women more than him. And then he refers to women as that. You think I'd do that? You know.
Yeah,
yeah right. You really respect women.
If you're stupid enough to, you're stupid enough to talk that way, that means you're craven enough to act that way.
Of course.
And Billy Bush. Oh, go ahead. We're out of time. Respond to whatever you want to say.
Okay, I want to say a couple things. First off, I don't need anybody prosecuted. Having suffered horrible injustice, I need no one prosecuted for the crimes committed against me that didn't commit them. So that's why I'm cautious about things. I don't need anyone, you know, put through that crap. The second thing about McMartin and some of these other, a couple other big cases, when one of those happens, you get the cover of Time Magazine, the New York Times, all the stuff, giant articles. I wanted to do, this is just my little statement I wanted to make, but I wanted to do an art piece where you take half the art gallery and you put up these giant Time Magazine articles. And the other half art gallery, you put little one-inch stories from page 38, when there used to be a page 38, of bona fide cases of child abuse, and you just match it space-wise. So you have 16,000 stories on one side, and you have 14 on the other. Okay? So that's just how I would make that point. Are there bad prosecutions? Do people, you know, accuse people of stuff they didn't do? Well, of course they do. And I don't want anyone, that's why we deal with this stuff on a case-by-case basis, and we try to make sure that there is justice, you know? So that's my response.
Okay, and we got to wrap it up, but I talked over you on the false memory, so please, I apologize. Tell me about the false memory.
Well, this guy, Ralph Underweger, he was who, quote unquote, wrote the science about false memory. And it was just, I mean, and then he accused everything else, you know, traumatic amnesia. Well, that's all junk science. That's what they call it. But he comes up with junk science himself. It's clearly, and he had an agenda. This guy gave an interview to the Journal of Pedophilia called Pedica in Holland. And in it, he said things like, well, women, he was a real misogynist. He said, well, women are just threatened by the sexual connection men and boys can have, and like just a bunch of other outrageous stuff. He never thought anyone would see the damn thing. Well, when it came out, this guy who had been going around as the expert witness discrediting legitimate abuse survivors and victims in trials, he was going around and getting and getting cases thrown out of court until the word got out on him and what he did. And then it just sort of slowly dissipated. Unfortunately, that false memory term remains in the vernacular. But I just want people to know from, you know, who it came. And that's Ralph Underwager. You look him up.
I will look him up. And people should look up Barry Crimmins and follow him on Twitter and see the movie Call Me Lucky. And hopefully we will...
And a new one, Call Me Greedy, if we get that done.
That's my documentary.
Yeah, you're Mr. Greedy, you are.
Yeah. So hopefully we'll do some stand-up together.
Yeah, hopefully soon, too. There's a bunch of stuff coming up, and we'll talk. Yeah. You know, call me when we're not on the air, and we'll figure out some stuff, but I'd love to, you know, I always love working with you. You're the best. Just so dry and hilarious and such a deft touch. It's just, you know, it's wonderful to see you work anytime. So, yeah, let's do it real soon, brother.
Are you done with praising me?
I'm done.
Okay.
That's all you get.
That's all I get? Okay. That felt good. Barry Crimmins, thank you. We'll talk to you soon.
David Feldman, love you, brother. Take care.
Love you, too.
Thanks
thank
for
you.
Having me.
Thank
Goodbye.
You. Hey, that'll do it for us. Remember to friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. And don't forget to go to the David Feldman Show website, davidfeldmanshow.com. Do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. We have a treasure trove of old episodes. And give us a good review on iTunes. It helps move us up the charts from the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan. That'll do it for us.